Melinda Audio presents this unabridged recording of Sunburnt Country, Stories of Australian Life, edited by B.R. Coffey, written by various authors and read by Beverley Dunn and James Wright.
John A. McKenzie, Beginning. I was born in 1916 on the Western Australian goldfields. But my memoried life began when my father gave up mining and took on farming at Arthur River in the Great Southern District. Until I was old enough to go to school, I roamed about the paddocks and the bush as far as my legs would carry me and as long as daylight time allowed. The bush was a living presence that breathed around me and in me, and I was one of the creatures in her plenitude of life. I met all kinds of bird, animal, and insect life at the close looking of a child. When I walked through the wheat, it moved above my head. In spring, the colour and smell of orchids were close to my eyes and nose, and a rash of everlastings pinked the ground. I paddled in the creek, where the banks loomed over me with shadowy cold. In winter, the rain stormed on the iron roof, rivered into the tanks, and muddied the earth. I woke in the morning when the air shocked and the ground dragged heavy with dew. On the bushes hung perfect patterns of spiders' webs. On the far side of the woolshed, wheat seeds had burst through the ground overnight and tinged the paddock with an unfamiliar green. When I walked in the bush, the bobtail lizard flashed a silent threat with his blue tongue. Booty rats and tammers looked with careful eyes. Hakea seeds split open like birds' beaks. Flannel flowers and tadpoles grew together in the swamp. The wind talked alternately strong and weak in the she-oaks, and ring-necked parrots coloured the gums. Plovers sat all one way on the fence, stubby tails behind the wind. The farm was a country by itself. As the days grew, I explored in many places, ever with the delight of finding something new. A prickle of parrot bush, a swoosh of she-oaks, humps of granite outcrops, gravelly ridges, canyons of creek beds, a jam tree, green and round as a head, gum leaves wet and glittering in the sunlight. Once I went too far and gulped with fear of never finding home. Would I be caught like Goldilocks in the birdman's net? Meet the fairy woman in the moonlight who spins a silver thread for a snare. Fall down a wombat hole and be lost forever in the dark underground. A tammer jumped before me and stopped. I followed him, and found the home gate and the house and my mother standing at the door, shading her eyes against the setting sun. I ran in and comforted myself against her thigh. In high summer, my brothers and I went down to the orchard and lay under the hanging branches of fermented grapes and got drunk and vomited on our way home as the sun went down like a dancing head. We went barefoot everywhere and washed our hands and faces in the mornings only. One day, I ran a splinter of dry wood into the bottom of my foot. My mother applied a linseed poultice, which I left on for days, until the rag was the colour of the ground. When I took it off and looked at my foot, it was strange to see the skin white as salt where the poultice had been. One day, my two older brothers and I were put to drive a flock of sheep from one paddock to another. We worked without a dog and had to spread out to keep them moving. Andy was having trouble with a weak lamb that wouldn't keep pace with the mob. Two or three times he picked it up and threw it in among the other sheep to find its mother. We got the mob through and shut the gate. But still the lamb stayed with us, calling in a weak, high voice. Andy said it must be a twin, and its mother wouldn't take it. He took it to a tree, took out his pocket knife, and slit its throat. The blood gushed out in spurts. We piled rocks on it to hide it, but the blood trickled through along the ground. Years later, someone read me the story of Cain and Abel, and the memory jumped when I heard the words, "What hast thou done? Thy brother's blood crieth unto me from the ground." It was murder, and that living thing really was my brother. I saw blood again soon after, and this time it was my own. My mother was getting the evening meal. I pestered her for bread and butter, and she tossed me a piece which landed on the plate upside down. I held it out, squawking that there was no butter on it. She stopped cutting the meat from the joint and made to hit my arm with the flat of the knife. But I moved, and the knife struck edge on. I saw the skin open up clean with a V-shaped slit, and the blood spurted. My mother reached up to the shelf behind her, grabbed the tin of Zambuk, picked up the baby's napkin, scooped up a large daub of the ointment, bunged the bandage on my arm, and tied it tightly. For years after, I was able to boast of the 5-centimeter white mark on my arm and weave romantic tales of how it came about. I met death again, but did not see the event. Our best 2 horses, Nigger and Tan, got into the shed during the night and gorged themselves so full of oats that, as Andy said, their bellies burst, and they were found dead in the morning. Dad fastened a rope to the stallion and led him as he dragged the corpses into the bush, where they were burnt under a pile of dry wood. When the fire died and the ashes cooled, only their bones remained. The loss of Nigger and Tan made more work for the horses that remained. On Sundays, they were let out to graze in the home paddock. We were eating lunch when we heard squeals coming from outside. The stallion had mounted one of the mares. Dad went out to drive him off. I thought it unfair when they were only playing piggyback. I heard Dad tell Mother that he was too late, but that it would make up the numbers. Only later, when a foal was born, did I understand what he meant, and I learned how life came in the way all farm kids do. The foal was given to Andy, and he rode her once a week to the settlement to pick up the bread and the mail. Now and then strangers came to our place. I did not know that people could be black until a group of Miles, seeming to emerge from the trees themselves, walked up to our house carrying spears, standing on one leg, picking up stones with their toes, talking in a strange tongue, and looking with dark eyes. My mother gave them Dad's tobacco and some flour, and they went quietly away back into the trees. We never saw them again. Red-haired Hetty from the next farm came blubbering and stumbling across the home paddock, a pair of binoculars around her neck. Her 2 little brothers had got lost in the bush. Hetty was a grown-up young lady, and she frightened me by crying like a kid. Dad came out and put his arm around her shoulders, and they went off together to join the search. My mother stood at the door for a long time and watched them go until they disappeared over the rise. Then she laid down on her bed and she cried. Why were all the grown-ups acting queer? I picked up the cat and went to the shed and sat among the bags of chaff and found a nest of little newborn mice, but could not stop the cat from eating them all. Dad was a great singer of songs. He had taught himself to play the piano and could read music as well as play by ear. He was reckoned a good dance pianist and was hired for the socials that were held from time to time in different parts of the district. At home, as well as the piano, he played the piccolo, banjo, violin, squeeze box, tin whistle, mandolin and mouth organ. On winter nights, he piled the fire high, brought in a dead tree, laid the butt end and the grate and its length along the floor. As the evening wore on, he shoved the unburnt shaft up along to keep the blaze alight, while we grouped around the piano and sang about the doings of Barney Google with the goo-goo googly eyes, and about the Greek who kept a fruit store with all kinds of fruit, but yes, we have no bananas. We have no bananas today. There was a mildly rude one with the refrain, "All the monkeys at the zoo have their faces painted blue. Horsey, keep your tail up, have yours painted too." And one about the girls who were invited to "Roll 'em down, girls, roll 'em down and show your pretty knee." There was a long tale of impossible adventures in which the hero boasted, "I've bought diamonds 15 a penny there. I've travelled everywhere, nowhere and anywhere. I'm the top-notch curl of this wide, 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 wide world." He met up with an astonishing alligator. From the tip of his nose to the tip of his tail was 45,000 miles. He told of cannibals, funny-looking animals, met while travelling the length and breadth of Patagonia and Ticalonia. Then there were the sad songs Dad seemed to like the best. Mostly songs about partings. "Oh, it's time for parting, and my tears are starting. Leave me with a smile. Maybe it's forever, so while we're together for a little while, hold me like a flower for one little hour. Leave me with a smile. For hours, days, and years, some unknown girl had to suffer us yearning just for you and to accept that we would be loving her always." Although we had never seen the sea, we sang about it, and with all our lives before us, we retired to some out-of-the-way corner and, with a pal good and true, let the rest of the world go by. Then at the end of the session, we cheered up, put on them golden slippers, and doodad happily with the camp-down ladies while the piano almost rocked over with the vamping chords. My two older brothers and I started school together when the little one-teacher building at Minding opened in the early 1920s. Dad blazed a trail with the axe 5 kilometres for us to follow through the uncut bushland. In the winter, we squelched in the mud and crossed the creek on a log. In the springtime, the spider orchids grew along the track by the thousands, and everlastings spread for miles. In summer, bull ants, booty rats, bobtails and snakes showed themselves, and once a spiny anteater. One day we wagged it, built ourselves a little bough humpy, and sat in it and ate our lunches too early. We got home to find our grandmother come to stay, while our mother was away finding us a new baby. When my brothers saw Grandma, they escaped, but she cornered me and demanded to know if we had wagged school. I obeyed my brothers and told her we'd got all our work right and had been let off early. But I knew she was not deceived. There were 12 kids in the school. I sat next to Alice, at a flat bench on a 5-foot form with a narrow backrest that dug into my shoulders. Alice was the first girl I ever spoke to. She was a bold girl. On my second day, she asked me about my dick. We bargained that I would show her mine if she showed me hers. When the teacher was at the back of the room, I popped it out under the desk, and Alice peeled down her drawers and gave me...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.